Talk about a bit of tinkering on the edges of how those ideas from neurobiology, can support practice, and certainly what I've found don't contradict practice in any way, but actually it's like a narrative. The narrative approach responds to all of that. Is a practice that fits with that. But that's why I'm so excited to have the opportunity here with you guys, because you do have. That so much more of that of the biology and the neurobiology to bring in, and I'm excited at the possibilities of this bridging and this making links.
I've been studying somatic experiencing, and that's a body-based therapy. And what it really invites us to do is to be aware of the body sensations and experiences about anything, but about emotions or about a story, and as a way to also further strengthen that, in some ways it would be consistent with strengthening the landscape of action when you think about this positive step you took now and you reflect back on it. Well, how does that register in your body, that appreciation? And so it brings it forward more fully on the sensory level, on a, it can be on a visceral level or other kinds of physical sensations, or awakening memory that's stored not just in the brain, but like in the whole body, that certain gestures or certain things we do, like, when we work with people and they're like, these kinds of things. And we can pause, we can loiter and linger in these moments when people are physicalizing these things, because it's another way of strengthening that story. And then again, that allows people to then make meaning and get connected with the concepts of life that they're wanting to be staying true to. Like, you can, do that. So it's like this whole other, it's like the whole other landscape, like the landscape of the body has another.
The brain makes certain things possible and sets the stage, but I agree that it doesn't make things intelligible.
Yes,
so we need it, but it's from meaning and social practices, and I even think about feelings and memories and sensations as story that we enact and tell, that I think too often are held privately. And I took up an interest of, I think about Rachel Hare Mustin's work of the mirrors in the therapy room, and what happens when we leave out that whole language. That's those stories, that I think people are coming in with and hold privately, but how do we make them visible and put them back in the room? And I think starting at the Renfrew Center, where there was dance and movement therapy and play therapy and art therapy, psychodrama, thinking about the physicality of all language has always been close at hand for me. That was part of thinking about language, different kinds of language.
Different sorts of expression.
Different sorts of expression and healing. So it didn't make sense to me to only think about talk and as language.
Like the language of gesture, the language of movement.
The language of sensation.
Yeah.
I remember Tom Anderson, I'll never forget, he was in California, and he was telling a story of, well, two stories, but one of somebody throwing something across the room. And like, what is that hand saying when you're throwing that plate? Or when he was talking about somebody cutting, and he said, the hand that's cutting, what is this hand saying? And then what is this arm saying? The arm that's being cut, and just putting words and images to actions.
And I think that is, for me, what the narrative approach offers, is to be able to language these stories that are implicit in the action, in the experience, in the emotions, and to actually, do something that is more than just expressing them, and continuing to express them, but to make meaning, through story, and that it does offer the tools or the practice to be able to bring language to those things. And I don't know if that is always necessary, though. You know, like there are lots of ways of working and responding to trauma that say we don't need to.
Sure,
but I think it's just such a loss to not bring the story, not bring the meaning. Yeah, that because the understanding has become such a tool or a possibility, a resource for change. So it seems
we're making meaning in relation to our body. I mean, even when I'm thinking about working with someone who has a body-based experience that they're having, whether it's a psychiatric body-based experience or a physical one, even though it's in their body in a way, it's actually external to their identity. And that's one of the ways I really talk about it. So it's not an interiority, even if it's a physical phenomenon, like someone who may be experiencing a biologically based depression or other kind of psychiatric state, like mania or even psychosis, that it's external to their identity. And that's the way I think about it. So in a very syntonic way, like any other kind of experience.
A very which way?
Syntonic with narrative. It's very consistent with narrative. Uh-huh. Because it's the meanings we give to the experiences that we have is what constitutes our sense of self and opens up the possibilities for moving in directions that our lives want to go in.
And do you find that people are able to put words, to put language and to those experiences? With
those of different kinds of psychiatric states, absolutely. And they're really happy to do it. And it's actually pretty easy to do it because people may be talking about things like anxiety or feeling paranoid, being anxious, and I'll just, you just make that switch to using a noun to talk about those kinds of states, like depression, if that's the language they're using, anxiety or paranoia or whatever it is. And then they can have a relationship with it. Just like anything else. And in this context, then, there's lots of different resources we might want to be introducing to help people. Other things that that we might want to be make available, like when you've been using EMDR, is that right?
Yeah, I think about politically.